Hello everyone. I would like to start with saying thanks to Hermes Airport for inviting me to be here today. It's my first time in Cyprus and I arrived last night and I will go back tomorrow morning, 7 o'clock, so I have to come back soon again to stay for a longer time. But what I'm going to talk about here today is what has been happening in Iceland over the last 5 years. We have been going through difficult times, starting with a bank crisis, and then a volcano eruption that you all know about. So I'm going to go over this period and how we at the airport and how the tourism industry has been coping with this situation and turning this into opportunities. So this is the picture we see from 2008, early October. The Prime Minister of Iceland asked God to bless our country. And we really needed that at this time. And overnight, the loans that we had in foreign currency doubled, and the cost of traveling abroad for the Icelandic people doubled. So this was a difficult time and changed a lot in our operation at the airport. This was the situation out on the streets. This is not the case anymore. People are more relaxed and this was has never happened before. So there was a lot of anger out there in the community. And this got a lot of attention on Iceland as well. Not very positive, but still it was attention. For the airport operation, this changed a lot in the passenger mix. So from 2007 to 2009, we lost out a lot of the Icelandic travelers. And in those 2 years' time, we lost 40% of the Icelanders out of the system. And why is that important? It's because in Iceland, we have high taxes and high duties. And that meant, lost in revenues for us. And those revenues from the duty-free business are very important for our operation. But at the same time, decrease of the Icelandic krona also brought us some opportunities that I will come and talk about a little bit later for the travel and tourism industry. Decrease in passenger numbers at the same time, and this was a pretty difficult time for the airport to operate because in 2007 we had renovated the terminal and that was financed with loan in foreign currency. So you can imagine what that meant for the operation. So in 2009 we still saw a decline. In 2010 we had this news, Eyjafjallajökull. And some people say today that this was probably one of the best marketing campaigns for Iceland ever. It's not funny to say it because I know it caused a lot of problem for the air travel industry, but still, I think it helped us to be and get on the map. And this eruption kind of taught us how we should work every day. This was a crisis situation. We had to react from 1 hour to another. And this is a picture of the information we got from the Met Office in the UK. And this is what we used to look at, can we open this airport? Is this airport going to be closed down in the next hours? So from minute to minute, we can say this was the information that we used in our operation. The biggest user at our airport is Icelandair, and it's a very good and successful operation of their that company. And they moved their hub to Glasgow during that period, and also they moved a part of operation to Akureyri when they were not able to fly to Glasgow. And that meant pre-positioning of the crew, that meant moving a lot of staff both to Glasgow and to Akureyri. And they had to be very spontan and make decisions very quickly. And we can say afterwards that this, they made crisis management look easy, like the media picked up. This is a picture from Akureyri where you can see, one of their aircrafts being offloaded. This is a picture of the table that Icelandair used in the crisis committee. And there you can see in the corner up to the right that this is day 9. So this is the 9th day of the eruption of Eyjafjallajökull. And this is how they were managing, where the aircraft should go to and where they were coming from. So So the challenge at that time was, in April 2010, we lost 22% of our visitors out of our system. And you can imagine you don't want to travel necessarily to a destination where you have eruption going on, you don't know when you're going to be able to go back home. So it was, we could understand that. And also research showed that the image was severely affected. So we needed to do something. We couldn't just sit there and wait and see what Eyjafjallajökull was going to do and how long he was going to go on. So we joined forces and it was decided to look at this as an opportunity. And this is a big question. When there is a crisis situation, people can work together and it's very easy. Just make decisions and you just do. Don't ask why should I do it, why shouldn't he do it, how much does it cost, and so forth. Just do it. So that is what we did with the government, city of Reykjavik, and the big and strong tourism companies in Iceland. We came up with Inspired by Iceland, and that was the brand, and that was the message that we sent out. Because this was what we saw in the media abroad. And if you look at those pictures, you don't want to go there. It doesn't look very good. But this was only the case for a part of the country, a small part of the country. But the other parts were up and running and business as usual. So in the beginning, three goals were set for this campaign, Inspired by Iceland. So we needed to reverse the decline in tourism numbers, and we needed to work on the attitude and tackle the rumors head on. And we also wanted to inspire people to tell positive stories about Iceland. Because there were a lot of people out there that had been to Iceland, people from Iceland living abroad, and our contacts and friends. So that was the goal of the in 2010, to start with. Someone calling. And also we needed to get this message out that Iceland was closer than you think. And I think everybody in Europe at least knew about that now, because the ask could go, was closer than they thought before from Eyjafjallajökull. So this was one part of the message we needed to send out. And the approach that was taken is a website called inspiredbyiceland.is. That is the heart of the project. And there we were sharing the stories from Iceland, which was part of the first campaign that we launched. Also, we were working very heavily with social media because we had limited funding and we needed to get the message out quickly and to as many as possible. And later on, we worked with PR and media visits and also events in Iceland that we broadcasted online and so forth. But the heart of the project was the website. And another thing that I think is very important is that we came up with a guiding light. And we said that Iceland is not for everyone. And we defined the kind of visitor we wanted to get to Iceland. And maybe I just read it for you. They say, Iceland, it is not for everyone. It isn't for those who go where everyone else goes. It is not for the conservative and expected traveler. It is for those who travel the world to experience something different, to come back with stories to tell. The stories of Iceland don't stop as winter comes. They get even more adventurous and more magical, 365 days a year. So welcome to all those who travel with the spirit of adventure, exploring and creativity. It may not be the first place you think of traveling this winter, but it will be the first place you tell your friends about. So come and be inspired by Iceland. And this was the guiding light for the marketing campaign. So we needed to be exact on which visitors and which guests we really wanted to attract. So this was the first campaign we launched on June 3rd, 11 days after Eyjafjallajökull stopped erupting. We sent out messages and asked the Icelandic people to send messages out to all their contacts abroad, all the families and friends, and tell them, please come to Iceland, I will welcome you. Business is as usual. So also, if you have a story to tell, go to the website and tell the story. So today we have hundreds of stories in this website from different people all around the world where they are sharing what they have experienced in Iceland and what they think, you know, Iceland has to offer. Also together with this, the airport had been working with Promote Iceland, and I think this is also a key. The airport took a lead in this cooperation with Promote Iceland and said, we are talking to the airlines. It's not enough for us to tell them, you know, how much it costs to land here. you have to help us to convince them about the destination. We are not the best people to do that. You are the experts there. So we have been going to conferences, roots conferences, over the last years together with them. And the airlines, they say, you know, we need to talk to them also. But they want the airport to lead the cooperation, but also they want to be able to have a discussion with the destination, and promote Iceland is taking care of that in Iceland. But this is, of course, it does matter, but we also need to establish some kind of a funding to be able to work with individual airline to promote the destination, because they have a very strong channels through their websites, through their sales channels, that we need to take advantage of. Because we are a small island, and we don't have the funding to go and buy a lot of billboards in the subway in London or other destinations we are competing with. Also, like you did here in Cyprus, we introduced an incentive program, and that incentive program also was in line with the goals of the Inspired by Iceland. So we are giving more discounts and support in winter than we are doing in summer, and also for the passenger increase bonus, we don't give any bonus out for June, July, August. We don't need it. We have enough passengers, we have a lot of visitors to Iceland during that time, so we are constantly trying to increase traffic in off-season. So when 2010 and the first campaign was finished, we set the goals for the next 3 years, 11 to 14. And then the goals were to strengthen the image of Iceland as a destination year-round, and to increase number of tourists in off-season, and also to increase commerce from tourists. So now you can see there was not this crisis situation as before, but still we had some goals to increase number of tourists in off-season. So now I'm going to give you a little insight into one of the campaigns we did, and it shows you a little bit about how we were able to get the whole nation, all the people in Iceland with us in this campaign. And we invited people to our homes. So Inspired by Iceland asked the people of Iceland, can you offer foreign visitors coming to Iceland to come to your home, to bake pancakes for them, or maybe even to go for a walk with a dog, so they can experience how it is to be in Iceland with an Icelander. So here's a small video that shows how it worked.
Hello. My name is Ólafur Ragnar Grímsson.
I'm the mayor of Reykjavík.
We are going to invite you to a very special concert.
And a tea of Thermarkool.
I'm going to have a birthday party.
And you take us.
You're all invited.
This old town can turn
gives you some insight into, you know, what we did and how we did it and the message that we were sending out. So the president of Iceland, he didn't bake the pancakes, but he invited people to his home to have pancakes, and we used that for the PR and the media and on the social media, and you know, this has been a success. So in this campaign, which is currently just the way we present Iceland as we don't want to say a destination, we say experience. This is the message we are sending out. We say Iceland is adventurous. You can walk on a glacier and it's pure. And we have Blue Lagoon, which is one of the wonders of the world, and we present that. It's sustainable. We use renewable heat to heat more than 90% of all our houses in Iceland. It's creative. It's cultural. Mysterious. And then we have new opportunities that we think are going to give us a lot of attention and also bring more guests to Iceland. And this picture shows Tom Cruise when he is filming Oblivion, his new movie. And the newest one, The Secret Life of Walter Mitty, was also filmed in Iceland. So this is also, you know, giving Iceland a lot of attention out there. But attention is a good thing, and we have been voted the hottest destination and of some of this travel media, and that is great, and we are very thankful for that. But did we reach the goals of the project? You know, was this a success? The short answer is yes. We were able to strengthen the image of Iceland as a destination year-round in the survey that we've done in the main markets in Europe. Also, we were able to increase number of tourists in off-season, and we exceeded this 12% annual goal that we set. And also, we increased commercial tourists, and the measurement we're using there is refund of VAT. This is what we came up with at that time, but this is one way to measure it. So we have exceeded and reached the goals that we have set in the project. This has also meant that we have been able to attract new airlines to Iceland. And in 2011, we had 3 airlines flying year-round. Today, we have 6. So this is has been successful, and we are very proud of having been able to work with those airlines. Here I'm showing you the network of Icelandair. Of course, they are a key player in all of this with their network, both to the States and Europe. And their business is creating the hub in Keflavik, partly together with bringing point-to-point passengers. And new destinations like Denver and Seattle, Edmonton, those routes are mainly driven by people going over the sea, but still they bring passengers to Iceland, you know, that would maybe never have come to Iceland if we wouldn't have those routes. So, of course, it's very important to have good airlines, not just whatever airlines, we have to choose them carefully. So this is the passenger development. So we've seen a growth, and some might say too steep growth into the future. We are probably not going to see those numbers, but this is the case for now. And we have to expand the terminal, and we have to add more gates, and gives us a lot of projects to work on. If you look at the markets and we say, okay, you know, who are the target markets in this campaign for you? We changed the target markets from winter to winter. So, for example, the first winter we had 4 target markets, Boston, New York, one winter, London has been one of the target markets, North and Norway, and also we have had, you know, Germany, France, those main markets. So we have seen a growth from all of those places, from all of those markets to Iceland. Of course, it's not, we can't say it's only the campaign or it's only the attention Iceland got. You have to have seat capacity added to those markets to be able to bring more passengers, and this together has been success. So the key to the success story, like I said before, there was a crisis and we had to act quickly, and that is a question that I think is very interesting to understand. What happens in a crisis? Why are people so willing to work together in this situation that they just do? And how can you create that environment, you know, without being in a crisis situation to have people to work closely together? Cooperation between companies and the government, as well as the airport and Promote Iceland. I'm very happy with the cooperation I have with Promote Iceland today, but I'm not there yet. I need to find ways to work with them more closely, and they have to understand that they are part of those partners that have to work with the airlines. It's not only the airport. Decreased value of the Icelandic krona, of course, helped us, because, you know, Iceland was more affordable than before. So, you know, it's not only the campaigns, it's something that we couldn't control and was just a part of the situation. We have been in the spotlight, and this was the first time that Iceland as a destination were able to send out single message. And that's very important, and now we have some platform to build on. How we involved the Icelandic nation into the campaigns was very important, because the tourism industry in a small island, or I say small in Iceland, but we are still much bigger than Cyprus, and if you look at the size, it's very important because this industry affects all of us. So we need to involve the nation also, so they work with us on this. And we did that with asking them to invite people to their homes, to send out the message, and then also I will show you the newest campaign that we call Share the Secret, where we are asking people of Iceland to share the small secrets they have. Because it's not always about going to the tallest building in the destination or going to Blue Lagoon in Iceland, which is, you know, one of the wonders of the world. It's the small things that involve, you know, connections with the locals or doing something special that people haven't done before, you know, and told everybody about. So I think it was a huge success how we were able to involve the Icelandic nation in the campaign. And then we had defined market segment, like I told you, this enlightened traveler that we had defined. Target markets were set for each winter, and we measured how we were doing, also with the clicks and how many people came to the website, and also with number of visitors to the country, and how much they were spending. And we did something different. We had to do that because the government was putting 1.8 million euros into this campaign a year, which is no money in the context of the competition in the world of destinations. So we needed to find a way to do it efficiently and using the media that we have today to reach out to the markets. So I want to end this with showing you the newest campaign that we are launching, Share the Secret. And I hope to see as many of you as possible in Iceland in the next years.
Þetta sem hún er nægjalt í mér Það enginn stíð þar sem hann gengur
Heima, nærum og heldur